actually want to eliminate and eventually eradicate trypanosomiasis, because that is the target in an important target in sustainable development goals to be attained by 2030. So my overview will be, what is African trypanosomiasis? Looking at the trypanosomes and their glossiness. Yeah, glossiness here is like jargon words, talking about sexual flies. Now we are going to look at the burden of African. Actually, a disease of human and livestock caused by a unicellular flagellated protozoan called trypanosoma. And it is one of the neglected tropical diseases listed for elimination globally by 2030. It's still globally, although we have more of the cases in sub-Saharan Africa, which we call the African trypanosomiasis. The one we have in America, precisely in South America, we call it American trypanosomiasis. It's actually the Chagas disease and the leishmaniasis. So the Chagas disease is actually caused by trypanosoma protozoan, and it's not what is endemic. That type of trypanosomiasis is not endemic in sub-Saharan Africa. So we are not going to do anything to that. So taxonomically, we know that it's an eukaryote. It's a protozoan protist. Yes, kinetoplasta, because they have ancestry genomic DNA materials coming from our mitochondria, called their own kinetoplast. Their kinetoplast is their mitochondrial DNA. Yes, the other is Trypanosomatida, family Trypanosomatidae, genus Trypanosoma. But we have many species. In fact, to cause human trypanosomiasis, we have six well-known species of Trypanosoma. Next slide. Yeah, the trisomal trypanosome looks like this. Bruce discovered that in the early 19th century. Slender, long, motile, some are short, stumpy, some are intermediate. At different stages of development, they adopt this morphology. We will get to know very soon. Next slide. If you want to actually look at the structure of this trypanosome to appreciate it, you can see that it has one flagellum that moves from that, from the basal body, where it takes up the variant surface glycoprotein and traffic it back to the membrane, passing through the endoplasmic reticulum, passing through the erythrocyte, Golgi body. And of course, we have the kinetoplast that moves, yes, from the posterior end towards the anterior end at different stages of development. So for those of you who are doing this work from the north, I think you will understand it better. Next slide. Now, what is African trypanosomiasis? Trypanosomiasis that is endemic in sub-Saharan Africa. In the human arm, they are divided into, in the human arm, they are divided into the West African trypanosomiasis and the East African trypanosomiasis. Forget about that America, it's not part of it, sorry. So we have the West African trypanosomiasis, and if you look at it, for the African trypanosomiasis, it is actually the glossiness that serves as vector. For the America, like the Trypanosoma cruzi, which we are not interested in, is actually the triatoma type of insect spores that are playing that vectorial role. Next slide. So, what is the picture like? Now, we have West Africa and East Africa. In West Africa, the trypanosome that is responsible for trypanosomiasis is actually the T. cruzi gambiense. And in East Africa, it is actually the T. cruzi rhodesiense. If we pull them together, in Africa, 97% are actually caused by T. rutile gambiense. In other words, it is the West African wound that is even more of a burden than the rutile. But we have to also be mindful that the T. rutile gambiense is a zoonotic pathogen, because cattle are major reservoirs of this T. rutile gambiense. But humans are the only reservoirs of T. rutile gambiense. And we know T. rutile, one other difference is that gambiense infection is acute. Within 3 weeks, you will have manifestation, the clinical manifestation of the infection, from the blood stage to the brain stage, is ED, blood and brain. In the bloodstream, what is causing the problem is actually the host inflammatory response. Neutrophils, leukocytes, we produce pro-inflammatory cytokines that will trigger oxidative stress to lyse the erythrocytes. That is the beginning of the problem. Anemia. The mechanism of containing parasitemia of this parasite is actually antibody dependence to activate complement for phagocytosis. So it takes a lot of C3. So when you do assay of complement 3 level, you see that it depletes because of high consumption of that complement. Because the body, we also want to fight it. Like I said, with the same thing, it's acute. It easily goes straight to the brain. And it is in the brain that we have the manifestation of the sleeping sickness. Human, we call it sleeping sickness. In animal, we call it nagana. It is also animal sleeping sickness. But wait, still, gambiense could take years to manifest. It is very slow. It's a chronic infection. And what do you expect of a chronic infection? It gives room for host immune system to mount protective immunity to a great extent. And it's usually of low parasitemia. That is why we will get to that level when we are talking about diagnosis. Microscopy is grossly limited in detecting gambiense because of low parasitemia, because it elicits chronic infection. Next slide. Yeah, you can see the overlap. And what do I mean by overlap? Look at T. congolense, the trypanosome in cattle, like horses, antelope, and camels. Like cattle here, we are referring to goat, we are referring to sheep, we are referring to cow, isn't it, in short? Then you see that Crocina morsitans is also a vector, the same vector carrying TB rodentiense. That explains why TB rodentiense is also a zoonotic pathogen. That explains why TB rodentiense, cattle are reservoirs of this trypanosome, because they share the same vector, morsitans. Morsitans thrive well in savanna vegetation. Unlike Crocina palis, the vector for T. gambiense, that thrives well in riverine environments. We also have Crocina fusca that thrives well in rainforest, right? And so we have them. Chronic next, acute next time. So you can see that we have a lot of them. So those who are doing vector, the vector biology, I did a lot of literature search, and I can tell you there is so much positive of data regarding the vectorial distribution of Crocinus in Nigeria. Maybe inability to identify them by looking at the is it the proboscis, whatever you use. So we have molecular methods. Somebody can pick up a PhD work and do that. It's a gap. I search, trust me, I want to do presentation, it's like a party for me. So I did a thorough review. I hardly see. Somebody should pick that up. It's a very big gap. Next slide. Next slide. So what is the transmission like? Yes, infected cell stem fly. It is very important to know that not every cell stem fly is infected and they carry different vectorial capacity depending on the area, depending on the type, depending on the behavior of the pastoralis, the Fulani experts, right? So, and we have also been told that there is possibility of having vertical transmission. So from pregnant women to their newborn mother to their newborn, cattle to young cattle, blood transmission, sexual transmission. I was actually looking for evidence of this, but I didn't see for sexual and I didn't see for blood, but I saw for the those ones. But they say there is possibility. Yeah. So this is the life cycle provided by CDC that we are all following. There are two different developmental stages of trypanosoma. The one in the vector and the one in the human host or the cattle host. You see, the one in the cattle host is the one we call trypanomastigot, that's in the blood. And that is what we examine when we make a blood smear of a cattle suspected to have trypanosomiasis or human suspected to have trypanosomiasis. Then we have the procyclic from the mid gut. When they invade the mid gut, they see them as procyclic. Then they move to the proventrum and become trypanosomiasis. Then to move to proboscis if it's rhodiensensei or salivary gland if it is gambiense. So we have the epimastigot then to the metacyclic form. But what is more important is that in humans it acquires the VSG to cover its membrane itself. It wears a coat when it is inside human host or cattle host. And that coat is what we call what? Variant surface glycoprotein. Evidence or studies have shown that this it changes this coat every 12 minutes. Every 12 minutes, this guy will change his coat. How I wish I can be changing my clothes every day, say every 24 hours. But this guy changes every 12 days. And it doesn't give the host immunity enough time to recognize it. As the host is building antibody against one coat, after 12 minutes, that antibody has expired. So it requires another one. But you see undulating parasitemia. When the antibody is working, the parasitemia will go down. When it changes its coat, the parasitemia will go up. And that happens with T. gambiense. It will happen like that for many years before you. And that is why T. gambiense is very dangerous. You don't see the early stage. By the time you are seeing clinical manifestation, it's the brain stage. Mind you, when trypanosomiasis gets to the brain stage, prognosis is very poor. Coupled with the terrible drugs around, we'll get to that later. So, next slide. So these are the glossinas, different types for pet people. It's just that we don't have it in Lagos. I would have recommended it for the likes of Mr. Galea, Afisuru, and Dr. Olola. Do we have, sir? We have?
We have in Odoasis.
Okay. So it's one thing we can really look at. Vector is Viking Island. very low data. Next. Now, this is the distribution of the glossinas in Africa. If you look at Nigeria, we are seeing palis. I actually like this picture. This picture marries microbiology and parasitology together, because we are made to know that sexual fly carry bacteria. I know that they carry one important bacteria that I wrote proposal one time and I didn't get a grant for it. Wolbachia. And those that are tetracycline reduced and they reduce the longevity of glossina. I didn't know that they also carry all these bacteria. And they say that they play a role in supporting or not supporting the development of trypanosome inside the sexual fly. That is why most times you see that some sexual fly are not infected and some are infected. We need to do comparative microbial flora between infected and non-infected. Then we'll be able to identify those that play a crucial role in supporting development of parasites in the glossina. Next slide. So these are the livestock infected by glossinas. So, you know, in the north, we have two types. We have the Ndama complex. And we were told that they are relatively resistant. Those that the cattle that don't have one. So when immediately I read this, you know, whenever you want to do party, there is one place we used to go to Badagry. I'll be looking for the one that has home. This one is susceptible to people from the north. Am I right or wrong? They said that the humped one is more susceptible to sexual fly, trypanosomiasis, than the Ndama, the one that doesn't have hump. Yes. So the humped one, they call it boran cattle. And we have two varieties of boran cattle, the white and the brown. Afisuru, Patini, Ben, So the one that has hump, they are more susceptible to trypanosomiasis than the humpless ones. They also infect sheep, they infect goat, they infect horses. And that one is called Trypanosoma equipado. They infect horses, they infect pig. Next slide. And this is what I was telling you. The journey is from bite, it can create a sore, yeah, we call it cancer, to the blood, then to the brain, CNS. It passes through the blood-brain barrier. And what happens when it is in the blood? Because of inflammatory response initiated by cytokines and tumor necrosis factor, we have fever. We have anemia. Yes, we have weight loss. Oxidative stress is highly catabolic. We have weight loss. Loss of appetite. We have anorexia. And it goes between tissues. If it enters liver, it will cause hepatomegaly. If it enters the eye, it will cause something like conjunctivitis or cause blindness. Trypanosomiasis can blind. You know that? It enters the eye. If it enters the spleen, it causes splenomegaly. If it enters the lymph node, it causes lymphadenopathy. And by the time it crosses the CNS, it increases the cerebral blood pressure, causing convulsion, coma, sleep disturbance. You see, you discover that at night the guy will not sleep. During the day, the guy will be sleeping. Eventually, even during the day, the guy will not sleep. He put it in here, very close to death. And the ultimate is death. The moment we allow trypanosoma to cross the blood-brain barrier and enter the brain, prognosis is poor. You will know why prognosis is poor. Next slide. So these are the pathology we have that cause death in animals. All kinds. infectious anemia, congestive heart failure death, one pathology. Infectious anemia, weight loss, coma death. I know what is causing this sleeping sicknesses. A parasite specific metabolism of tryptophan, right? And we have that. We cannot make that. Humans will rather convert tryptophan to serotonin to modulate our mood and sleep. But the moment this parasite enters us, it will, instead of making serotonin, it will be converting our tryptophan to tryptophan. You know, a cytotoxic compound that destroys neuronal cells. So the person is sleeping, the neurons are dying, and death is the ultimate. So you can see almost blind this anemia. Abortion, anemia, death, weight loss. Different pathologies. Next. So what is the body? Let's look at the human perspective of it. Yes. The sessile fly trypanosome, they currently occupy 10 million kilometers square of land area belonging to 37 countries. We were told initially it was 36, but it's expanding from Zambia now. Zambia is now there, making 37. And we have 70 cases of ART every year, and between 3,000 to 5,000 people dying every year. ART has been linked to pregnancy loss and maternal death. So it's also contributing to our poor maternal indices. So if you look at Nigeria in Africa, it shows that trypanosomiasis is endemic. Areas where we are that is highly endemic. So if you look at East Africa, you see a lot of epidemics there. Next. Yeah. You can see that the play field for both the cattle and sessile fly, the play fields are shared and they overlap. So where you see sessile fly, you also have cattle there. And sessile fly are ravaging cattle. And they are allowing us to be so much involved in crop production rather than using animal power, because our animals are weakened by trypanosomiasis. You will see what will happen. What will happen is that we are losing 54 billion every year. We are losing 3 million livestock every year. We are losing additional 4 billion for not engaging animal power for our crop production. We are using a lot of meat production. I'll sit there with poor meat. I'll sit there with anemia and better demands. Next slide. So we have a lot of studies carried out so far, both in Nigeria and Kenya. This Olubayo I was tracking. I say the guy is working for Bilrad in Kenya. It's not in I saw a lot of papers of Olubayo, a Nigerian working in Kenya. Next. So we have some of them here, the Ankasa rams. Do you know all these names here? I think they are in Zaria. Next. Yes. The Ankasa rams. You know their name, you know them. That's very good. So I was actually looking for Professor Lux at 2. Next. Maybe I didn't get it. Probably. So we can see that. So Asokoro Abuja, they are doing, they look at pastoralist behavior, not just like what I told you. They determine the capacity of cattle to serve as reservoirs for trypanosomes. Next slide. So what is the control like? Control, diagnosis is a component of control, surveillance, human treatment, arena and ground spray of insecticide, sterile insect technique, insecticide net use, insect repellent use, insecticide and net use, improve animal breeding. Yes, in animal, chemoprophylaxis and treatment is allowed. You can't do chemoprophylaxis in humans, but you can do But look at the drugs that they give them. Phenylpyramine. Who is aware of all these drugs for animal casualties? Isometalmidium chloride, isn't it? Diminazine. Which one are you using in the north?
Diminazine.
Oh, that's good. Yes. Next slide. So you will see all these kind of features. For the tritomasticus, it will look like this. Gabiense will look like that. Gabiense will look like that. Lost it. Next. Then, for no parasitemia, just like we do for helminths too, you can do concentration by centrifugation. It is also possible. Next slide. But it has the merit. It's very poor at diagnosing TB Gabiense. So, in this part of the world, where TB Gabiense is a major cause of human trypanosomiasis, microscopy is useless. It's poor. So, most cases are seen at the late stage, where people when prognosis is poor, when prognosis is poor. From this study, blood examination is poor for Brucella, poor for Ebanzi, poor for bypass. Okay, relatively better for Congolense, 87.5% sensitivity. Next slide. When you want to know the stage of trypanosomiasis or trypanosomal infection in cattle, you collect blood, you also collect CSF sample. When you collect CSF sample, we look at, you count the WBC. In cattle, it must be more than 20. In humans, it must be more than 5. Then there is a particular type of adenoplasma cells that carry vesicles loaded with IgM complex. We call them mod cells. You see, this is like mod cells. When you do smear of CSF, and stain with tripal blue, you see the mod cells. Then protein concentration is usually greater than 25 milligrams per year. But believe you me, these diagnostic indicators are not specific. You can have in encephalopathy, you can get mod cells. In meningitis, you see protein greater than. So these are differentials. They are not really specific. Next slide. That's the antibody type. The beta DHG is actually an antibody against the DHG. And when the epitope is changing because of variation in the DHG, it may also affect the sensitivity of the ELISA. Next slide. So these are the various other methods that you can use. Next slide. So, yeah, based on this, you can also have a form of diagnostic algorithm that is no longer tenable in modern day research on trypanosomiasis if we actually want to eliminate it. If we want to eliminate it, it's no longer tenable. Next slide. So we have proteomic now, like the Mandelbrot, we have Cellbrot, we are using it. This is a form of molecular. Next. And this is the kind of picture that you will have. Then they have myeloma cells as an internal control, and you can see the diagnosis of trypanosomiasis. It's more specific, it's a molecular method. Next. So, now, why is it that we really need to move out of phenotypic methods? Beautiful. Look at this picture, Africa. Most times, this trypanosoma species overlap. In an endemic area, you could get T. vibers, T. brucei, and T. congolense, causing trypanosomiasis in cattle. If you use cats, you will only be monitoring TB gambiensis. You will not be able to monitor budding of T. vibers and T. congolense trypanosomiasis. These techniques include all this, isn't it? Next. Molecular typing will discriminate, we have a repeated which we are doing. Then we need capacity building which we are doing now. We also need funding. Like I said, if this training was to be that you should pay. Will you come? Next slide. Thank you.
One more after him.
Thank you very much, sir, for this